Good morning and welcome to the 34th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have no apologies this morning, and our main item of business today is a continuation of evidence on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. And today we're continuing phase two of our scrutiny of the bill, focusing specifically on part four. And this covers the abolition of the not proven verdict and changes to jury sizes and majorities. So we're joined today by Ronnie Ranucci KC, Vice Dean of the Faculty of Advocates, Mr Stuart Munro, Law Society of Scotland, and Mr Stuart Murray, President of the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association. So welcome to you all. And I refer members to papers one and two. And I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. So as ever, I'm going to begin with a general question, and I'll maybe work from my right to left, and I'll bring in Mr Munro first, then Mr Ranucci, and then Stuart Murray. So can I ask why you believe that the not proven verdict should be retained as a third verdict?
Thank you and good morning. The Law Society's position, as is set out in its response to the call for evidence, is essentially this, that any criminal justice system is a complex system, the sum of its parts. The object of any system should always be to convict the guilty and acquit the innocent, and to do so safely. And we see periodically reminders such as the Horizon scandal of why it is so important to ensure that the balance is correctly calibrated. Our view, in essence, is this. The not proven verdict is one part of a greater whole that operates together to produce what we consider to be a broadly safe system. If you were to take one part of that whole away, such as through the abolition of the not proven verdict, you then put the system out of kilter, and other changes would have to be made in order to, as it were, compensate for that change.
Thank you very much. Ronnie Ranucci.
Good morning. I broadly agree with Stuart. The faculty's opposition has always been that you could not remove not proven verdict in isolation without replacing it with some other form of safeguard. We have a unique system in Scotland with the size of our jury and the fact that we have three verdicts. I think we are the only criminal jurisdiction where someone can be convicted of a charge of, for example, murder with a majority of one. And therefore, the three verdicts, I suppose, in some ways have provided a safeguard in relation to that. And if you are going to remove a safeguard, then you must replace it with another. That has always been our primary objection, the fact that you could not remove it without replacing it with something else. I have to say that I recognise that there is really no appetite anymore for the not proven verdict. And that's obviously a matter for Parliament. But we would stress that if that is going to happen, then there has to be some other safeguard put in its place.
Thank you very much. Stuart Murray.
Yes, thank you. Morning, and thank you for inviting me to give evidence today on behalf of the SSBA. Ultimately, what the profession says, what the SSBA states, is that this verdict, this not proven route for juries, essentially forms what is a safety valve for jurors. For example, a scenario whereby a jury may not be utterly convinced of innocence of an accused, but feels that the Crown have failed to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. And of course, that's the principal test. Mm-hmm. Have the Crown proven guilt beyond a reasonable doubt? And in cases such as rape, attempted rape, murder, serious sexual offences, and the matters that are more serious in nature that call on the highest court in the country, it is vital that there is that protection for accused persons.
Okay, thank you very much indeed for those sort of opening responses. I wonder if I can just ask a follow-up question. I'm going to ask the three of you again in the same order, if I may. So if we're looking at the sort of interests of having a sort of accessible and transparent justice system in Scotland. How would you define not proven? Because this is something that has come up in previous evidence sessions, that it, there is no definition of the not proven verdict. So how would you define not proven, were its meaning to be set out in legislation, for example? So, Stuart Munro.
Thank you. At the very basic level, it is exactly the same as not guilty. It has exactly the same impact as not guilty. It is a verdict of acquittal. Mm-hmm. We used to talk in terms of it being a matter of emphasis, that juries gave an indication as to their view of the evidence as a whole by selecting between not proven and not guilty. But that, I think, is very difficult to pin down. It's difficult to know what might be in the minds of individual jurors. We're prohibited by law from asking them, obviously. So I think ultimately the not proven verdict is no more than that. It is a matter of emphasis. It's an indication given by a jury, perhaps, that they're uncertain about the case. It can be a positive, in some limited cases, for complainers who feel that a jury is not, as it were, branding them a liar were there to be a not proven verdict returned as opposed to not guilty. It is equally, in some respects, unsatisfactory. The truly innocent accused might feel that they haven't had a fair verdict if the outcome is not proven rather than not guilty. But fundamentally, and from a legal point of view, it means exactly the same thing as not guilty.
Okay, thank you. Ronnie Rinucci.
I think ultimately it is perhaps a matter of emphasis. But again, I think it has to be remembered that our particular system, we don't operate within an inquisitorial system. Mm-hmm. The purpose of the jury is not to find the truth. The question for the jury is whether or not the Crown have proved the case beyond a reasonable doubt. So it's not with any a degree of certainty. It's beyond a reasonable doubt. And I think we should also remember that day in, day out, juries are given directions by judges, by sheriffs, that it is not a matter for the defence or for the accused to prove his innocence. It is a matter for whether or not the Crown can prove his guilt. And in many cases, you may find members of the jury where they may be perhaps not convinced of innocence, but the Crown have failed to meet that standard of proof beyond a reasonable doubt. And therefore, it allows the jury to perhaps give a more detailed verdict in the sense where they're saying, well, the Crown have failed in that and it's not proven. It also is perhaps, and this is perhaps where it comes into the sexual cases, in cases of rape, we must also remember that, again, they are fairly unique in that the jury are being asked to determine, well, whether or not a crime has been committed. In an instance where, in the normal course, sexual intercourse between two parties is not a crime. It becomes a crime when it's done without consent. So it's different from when you have a body with a stab wound in it, when we know already that a crime has been committed, and then it then becomes an issue of whether or not that person has committed the crime. But in many cases, a jury have got to decide in rape cases whether or not that crime has actually been committed. And again, it may well be that that is a better way of them expressing their view, that the Crown again have failed to establish even that, and therefore it's one of not proven. I think it does become very difficult to define it in any statutory form, if that was what one was thinking. But if it had to be, then I think it would be a matter of emphasis. It also has a place in our system at present where, again, if we are going to maintain a jury of 15 with a majority of 8, my view is that it could not possibly be taken away and we remain with the system we have. It is an integral part of that 15-person jury with the 3 verdicts because, again, it's for the Crown to prove beyond a reasonable doubt and they must have at least 8. But one can imagine a set where you've got 15 people where a number of people think the person's guilty, a number of people think that the person is not guilty, and there may be others who think, well, I don't think the Crown have proved their case. I'm not quite sure either way, but the Crown haven't met that standard that they're required, and therefore their verdict would be not proven. Mm-hmm. So that is why it fits very neatly within our criminal justice system at the moment.
Okay, thanks very much. Stuart Murray, you want to add anything?
Well, I think both my colleagues, firstly, have given fairly concise answers that I couldn't really go beyond. Their reasons are well founded. What I would say is that I would be reluctant to attempt to give a definition to the not proven verdict. I think that may well be a dangerous game. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the jury manual that judges use to give direction includes commentary on that, and that it may in fact not be advisable to give direction as to what exactly is the definition of not proven. And I think I'm right in saying, I stand to be corrected, but I think I'm right in saying that Professor Fiona Leverick gave evidence to that effect, mm-hmm. To this very committee. Mm-hmm. What I might also add is that, of course, the not proven verdict is part, as I've said, described it as a safety valve. It's part of a safeguard, a system of safeguarding accused persons. And other jurisdictions, other countries have safeguards put in place which I think go beyond that.
Okay.
And for example, unanimous decisions required in order to prove guilt.
Yeah. Okay, thanks very much indeed. I'm going to start bringing in members now. And first of all, I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor, then Sharon Dowie. Fulton.
Hey, thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Stuart Monroe, I just wanted to go back to something that you had said in your previous answer there, where you said, and it's something that we've certainly heard before as we've taken evidence over the last number of weeks on this, and that's that there's no difference in terms of outcome between a not guilty and a not proven. So therefore, I think to lay people, you know, as us as MSPs on this, why do you think, if there's no difference, why do we need the extra verdict and no other system has got it?
It's a fair question. And as I think the committee heard from Eamon Keane on the last occasion, the not proven verdict is a very interesting, you know, historical backstory. You could legitimately say we don't need a not proven verdict. We need a verdict of conviction and a verdict of acquittal, and that is the case in pretty much every other comparable jurisdiction. But we have it, and we have it probably because of historical accident as much as anything else. But it's become an embedded part of our system. It has become seen as one of the critical features that gives us the proper balance and allows, hopefully, that original aim, convict the guilty, acquit the innocent, to be best achieved. So you can make a perfectly cogent argument, say that we don't need it. I think the point that I was trying to get across with the previous answer, and I think the others have said much the same, is that if you take off that one particular bit of the system, there are consequences that have to be addressed.
So, and that brings me on to my second question. If have you got a feeling, because you've talked a lot about this balance, I think all three of you have, and I'll bring Ronnie and Stuart Murray in as well on this. Do you have a fear then that if the Parliament gets rid of the not proven, that either wrongful convictions are going to increase, or the opposite, that more people will walk free when they have been guilty? Have you, is that because you've talked a lot about that this is needed for the balance? So,
yeah.
Well, try and help us understand what would happen if that balance, as you're calling it, is taken away.
That is the logical concern. If the starting point is we think that our system pretty much gets it right and allows that balance to be struck correctly, then disturbing that balance will have ramifications. Now, it's very hard to give any kind of specific prediction as to how many wrongful convictions that might result in, but that has got to be the logical implication of it. There are other elements of our system that we have real concerns about. The simple majority verdict, for instance, which you don't see in any other comparable jurisdiction, and yet we allow it. We allow a conviction on the basis of 8 out of 15. You wouldn't see that anywhere else. It would be unconstitutional, for instance, in the United States. And convictions would simply be overturned if a jury tried to do that in many of these other jurisdictions. So, as I say, I think fundamentally we regard the not proven verdict as something that weighs in the balance set against these other considerations. And if you take away something that is regarded as a safeguard and don't address some of these other areas of concern, then yes, there would have to be a risk of an increase in wrongful convictions.
Rodney or Stuart Murray, have you got anything on that?
Yeah, I wouldn't say that there's no difference in them. There's no difference in the outcome, which is one of acquittal. But I do think that there is a subtle difference between not proven and not guilty. I know from speaking to colleagues in America, when I explained our system to them, they were aghast. And funnily enough, it wasn't how do you get convictions, it was how on earth do you get any acquittals in that system? And because you have to remember that the jury are not coming back with saying a matter for certain. There is always going to be an unknown. And perhaps a way of looking at the not proven system within our system at present with a jury of 15, you may have one group who are certain that or their view is that the person is guilty. You may have another group at the other end who are saying that he's not guilty. And there are a group in the middle who are undecided. Within that group, there may be some who are not prepared to say that the person was guilty, and some who might be who are not prepared to say that he wasn't. He was not guilty. And so, therefore, it allows the jury to come to a decision when you only have a need for a majority of one within the system we have at present. So it does operate as a safety guard, and it does allow juries to come to verdicts. But I wouldn't say that there's no difference. I do think it's a matter of emphasis. It allows juries to come to a decision even when they are not convinced that the person is guilty and they're not convinced that he is innocent.
Yeah, and you said that some of your American colleagues were shocked at how you would get acquittals in the system, but and I know other colleagues might want to come to the Scottish jury research, but the study, I'm just trying to find it here, and so I've got the figures right, but when the juries had two verdicts available to them in the Scottish research undertaken in 2019, they returned 3 out of 32 convictions, and when they had 3 verdicts available to them, they returned 4 out of 32. So, acquittal is very high, it would seem. But that's just a point, and as I say, other members might want to ask you about the Scottish jury research.
I think our view on the Scottish jury research is fairly well known.
Okay, thanks for that. So I don't feel the wrath of the convener. Just one final question to give you the opportunity, Stuart Murray, to answer on what I've been asking about.
Is there a fear of wrongful conviction? Well, yes, of course there is. Not only for the reasons that both my colleagues have laid out, but a concern from the profession, I think, that this is being considered at a time when other considerations are being looked at, which could completely alter the landscape of the criminal justice system in Scotland. For example, the development in Section 275, the ability or lack of ability to criticise somebody's character in court, the character of a complainer, for example, changes perhaps on the horizon to the law relating to distress and identification. And of course, I think this has been dealt with in the next session in January and February, but the proposals to put in place a pilot scheme for non-jury rape and attempted rape trials in the High Court. And this seems to come at a time when, along with those other proposals, it puts, I think, the criminal justice system in Scotland at risk of being adulterated, and access to justice and the rights of the accused, innocent until proven guilty, are at some substantial risk.
Okay, thank you. Sharon Dowie, then Rona Mackay.
Thank you. I was going to ask you about jury majorities. Now, you'd said earlier on about at the moment we've got 15 jurors and the decision maybe to send somebody to jail is based on the decision of one person, because we can go in 8 versus 7. So what's your opinion on unanimity? Would you like to see the change go to unanimity, or the other one was if the jury size had changed to 12, it would be 8 out of 12? So what would be your opinions on unanimity?
Start with myself. The society's position has long been that the current simple majority arrangement is not satisfactory and not tenable. No other comparable jurisdiction allows it. The broad approach that seems to be taken in all other English-speaking jurisdictions is that juries tend to have 12 people. Unanimity tends to be required, at least initially, and some jurisdictions will then allow something short of unanimity, effectively near unanimity. I think it's taking away a couple of outliers, but still then requiring unanimity from those who are left, rather than regarding it as a majority type system. And as I said earlier on, in the US, the Sixth Amendment effectively provides, or it's been interpreted by the Supreme Court as providing, for a requirement for unanimity, and even a 10-2 verdict in the US wouldn't be regarded as sufficient to justify a conviction. What that, I think, in practical terms does is it changes the dynamic of our juries so that the jury is regarded as a single entity. It's the jury as a whole that requires to be satisfied beyond reasonable doubt of an accused person's guilt, rather than individual jurors who then come to vote. And it may well be that there's something significant in that process, the instruction given to the jury that they have to try and reach a unanimous verdict. And what's interesting in the statistics that come from elsewhere is that in so many cases they manage to do that. It's pretty rare for juries to be unable to come to a verdict. Less than 1% of cases seems to be the number that's thrown about. But our position has long been that the notion that an accused person should only be convicted where the case against him or her has been proved beyond reasonable doubt is inconsistent with the idea that barely more than half of a jury can support conviction for that to be regarded as a conviction. So we are of the view that unanimity or something close to it, perhaps akin to the English model, is what Scotland should be looking at.
Thank you. Ronnie?
Yeah, in a case of a jury were going 8-7 and seven people were in favour one way or another, it's difficult to see how that there can't be a reasonable doubt in that entity when you've got seven people who aren't convinced, for example. If we are going to change the numbers, then I do think we should be striving for unanimity. And in all other jurisdictions where it operates a system with, for example, 12, it's either unanimity or it's a majority 10-2. There is no system that falls below 10-2. And I am aware that there's been discussions about 8-4, and I'm not sure where that has come from, because certainly there's no other system that operates that falls below 10. And I find it difficult to see where the justification for that would be. If we are going to change our system wholesale and go to 12, it's difficult to see what the justification is or where the research is for 8, for example, as opposed to the tried and tested formula, which is either 12 or 10. As Stuart says, in America, it has to be 12. In England, it has to be 12, unless, I think it's elapsed 2 hours, and then a judge can direct the jury that he's prepared to accept the majority. But that majority has to be 10, at least 10. So I'm not sure where 8 has come from. Even 9 would be better than 8, but it's difficult to see, again, where the justification comes from that without any research being done. And I don't mean to be flippant, but it's difficult to see where someone's just plucked a figure of 8 out of the air and said, well, let's just go for 8. I suspect it's because, well, it fits in neatly with 2/3. But again, what's the justification for that or the basis?
Thank you. Stuart?
Yes, well, I'd go slightly further. I mean, I agree with what both Stuart and Ronnie say, of course. The problem of coming third in a in a lineup where the majority or all of us are speaking from the same hymn sheet, that I'm repeating what my colleagues say. But what I would add to that is that I don't believe that the current system is appropriate, that a majority of 8 out of 15, the system should be stronger than that. There should be more built-in protections than that. As Stuart said, anything less than unanimous in most states in America, I think 48 out of 50, it's unconstitutional to have anything less than unanimity. I would suggest that the figures required for a verdict in Scotland should be raised from 8 to perhaps 10. And if, of course, the decision is taken, it will remain with 15 jurors. But even a reduction in the amount of jurors should retain a majority of perhaps 10. The problem is, of course, and Ronnie's touched on that there, that the research isn't in place to come to any real conclusion. And that is a theme in the way I think that the Scottish Government have made a number of proposals to landscape changes in the criminal justice system. There is a lack of research, and that has to change. We need to be provided with real research and not just limited research, which has been provided so far. And that's no criticism of those that carried out the research for the Scottish Government. Their hands, to some extent, were tied in the way that they could carry out that research. But it needs to change.
Can I just ask, what kind of research would you like to see?
Well, some research, frankly. There's been very little. And Scottish Government research, I mean, it's for a different day, perhaps, but looking at the jury system and the pilot scheme for removing juries from, as I said, Section 1 and attempted rape cases in the High Court. We can get into that if you want, but the amount of research that was carried out, and in fact the research that was able to be carried out, is almost non-existent, in my opinion.
There's the research down south, which has been done with real juries, real jurors, over many years. Cheryl Thomas interviewed thousands of jurors and has brought out research in relation to it. So there is data out there and there's research out there with real jurors. There's none in Scotland. And that's because, and again, I appreciate that those who were carrying out the research, their hands were tied behind their back. They weren't. They couldn't speak to real jurors. And that is why we had the mock research that we have. Even then, if we're going to apply mock research involving mock juries, our criticism of it was that it wasn't substantial enough. And my view is we should not be changing our whole legal system based on mock research, research with mock jurors, which really didn't in any way really mirror what actually happens within the courts. My understanding is that, well, I know that the mock trial lasted an hour. I have conducted between 250 and 300 rape trials in my career. I have never had a rape trial that's lasted only a day. And so therefore, to say this is good research, we've had a trial, but it only lasted an hour, and we're asking you to change our criminal justice system on that basis, I think we should really hesitate before making major decisions based on that type of information. And again, that's no criticism of those who carried it out, but there is research out there. And I would invite members to read the research that has been conducted by Cheryl Thomas. And she came to starkly different views. Her research comes to starkly different views than our research in relation to a number of important matters, particularly in relation to sexual offences.
Thank you. Just perhaps, sorry, to
Can
I just move things on. I'm just conscious of time. And can I also take the opportunity to encourage members, if you can just direct your questions to specific witnesses, unless it's absolutely necessary that you'd like a response from each witness, and then we'll just get through more questions.
Got one further question?
Yep.
Right, okay. I absolutely agree with you that the accused is innocent until proven guilty, but you also mentioned earlier on about difficulty in rape cases. If you've got a murder case, you might have a knife in somebody, you know there's a crime being committed. And at the moment, a complainer in a rape or sexual crime doesn't get individual legal representation unless there's a Section 275 brought in. So do you think there's maybe a case for them getting individual legal representation earlier? Could I ask that to Ronnie?
Well, as you'll know from our response, we're in favour of independent legal representation. And I would certainly be in favour of going further than it does at the moment, just in relation to Section 275s, but I would not be in favour of it in relation to taking part in the actual trial. That's what the Crown are there for. The Crown are there to prosecute the case, and then you have someone for the defence. If you were bringing in another party on behalf of the complainer, then it would become untenable. And it's impractical as well because, for example, I have got a trial coming up where there are 20 complainers. If you have 20 complainers who have each got separate representation, each trying to take part in the trial, our whole system would come to a halt. But I certainly have no difficulty. And indeed, we have said that we think that the independent legal representation could be expanded. And I think one of the things, the way it could, would be to help complainers with a degree of expectation of what is likely to happen within a rape trial, and to help them along the way, but certainly not in relation to actually taking part in the trial, no.
Maybe come in, we've just strayed a little bit off part four. Don't like to be too precious, but it's just in the interests of getting as much evidence on part four as possible. Okay, so can I bring in Rona Mackay?
Good morning, panel. I'd like to go back to something that Ronnie Brunucci said, which I think would be very offensive to rape victims. You said we're talking about sexual intercourse, but in fact it's sexual violence. So I'm sure you didn't mean it in that sense, but I just wanted to clarify that with you and you know, give you the opportunity to retract that.
I was referring to there's an allegation and what the jury have to decide, and the actual the facts involve sexual intercourse. The jury have to decide whether or not the sexual penetration. Then perhaps another way of putting it would be that the crime is one of sexual penetration of the vagina or anus or mouth without consent. In a normal case between two people, sexual penetration, when it's consensual, is not a crime. What the jury are being asked to decide is whether or not there was consent or not consent in relation to that physical act. I wasn't suggesting for a minute that it isn't a form of sexual... Of course, rape is sexual violence. That goes without saying. I wasn't suggesting that.
Okay. It was just the term that you used. I wanted to give you the chance to explain what you've just explained.
Well simply because of what the act is that's involved in it. Okay. Is not normally a crime, and the jury have to decide if it's a crime, but I wasn't intending anything other than that.
Okay. Thank you. You also said the jury is not there to find the truth, and it's for the legal system to prove the offence, and if they don't, it's a failing of the Crown. So can you understand why victims feel absolutely crushed and let down by a not proven verdict, and they feel that the system's weighted against them and in favour of the accused for the reasons that you've outlined. And many witnesses have said to us that they would much rather have had a not guilty verdict than a not proven verdict because they're left in limbo.
I can absolutely understand that. And again, that's why, touching on something separate, that's why I would support independent legal representation. Because if the position was explained perhaps better to complainers or victims, it might assist them. Because, for example, a verdict of not proven doesn't mean that the jury are saying that they are not telling the truth or they are lying. The jury are saying that, for example, may well be that a verdict of not proven can be returned, where the jury are not saying that that complainer was making that up and was telling lies about it. It's that the jury have not been convinced that the Crown have proven the case that it was rape. It was sexual intercourse without consent. And in some ways, a not proven verdict could be a comfort to complainers. But I just don't think it's been explained.
We've rarely heard that in evidence sessions.
I absolutely understand that. Yeah. But, for example, I have been involved in cases where it's clear that the complainer is generally of the position that she's been raped. The accused generally thinks that he hasn't raped her. And the jury are obviously undecided in relation to that question. Because, of course, it may well be... There are two aspects to rape, of course. It's rape if it's done without consent, or that the accused had no reasonable belief that the complainer was consenting. So in actual fact, you can have a rape case where, as a matter of fact, a complainer was not consenting, but nonetheless a verdict of acquittal could be returned if the jury find that, although that was factually the position, the accused had reasonable belief that she was consenting. That is our law at present.
Okay. Well, excuse me, the other aspect that we've heard in previous sessions is that the lack of transparency with a not proven verdict, in that the complainer does not know how many people on that jury thought that and how many people didn't. So it's another aspect of their, you know,
the accused
feeling
is
let down.
The accused is in the exact same position. No one knows what the split is. We're not allowed to know.
Well, why would that be? I mean, I know that must be laid down somewhere, but I mean, do you think that's fair, that nobody knows?
I don't have a view on whether that's fair or not. That's our system, and that's the system we operate at present. There is, I think that helps the jury with that knowledge, that their decision is not going to be questioned, it's not going to be analysed, it's not going to be torn apart to see, well, how many decided this, who were the people that decided that, or who
obviously not to identify people, but just numbers even, you know, would at least be some information.
Well, there are some times we do know. For example, if a jury goes down to 14, there have been occasions when you've been at 7-7. That has to result in a verdict of acquittal because you don't have the 8 that's required. Mm-hmm. But, well, then the only reason we have, I suppose, transparency in other systems is because they have either unanimity or 10-2.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyone?
I wonder if you just come in on that point. I mean, clearly, Parliament could provide that jury majorities should be ascertained and made public. That's within this Parliament's gift. I do wonder whether there's a public confidence issue there, whether if somebody is convicted, say, on the basis of an 8-7, whether there is then, you know, the media query whether or not that's truly a safe conviction, or indeed the other way, where there's a, you know, 7 people in support of guilty but not the necessary 8, whether that then undermines confidence in the acquittal of the jury, and what that might mean for the relationship between the public on the one hand and the system on the other. But that's a matter for Parliament to consider.
Okay, thank you. Can I just finally, Convener, just ask if everyone's in favour of legal representation for victims?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, the society. Can I just say the Society has been very supportive of the concept of independent legal representation. As Ronnie says, the exact parameters of that, what it means in practice, absolutely have to be identified. And there are, I think it's important to say, resource issues. You know, for instance, the case that Ronnie was describing with 20 complainers, are there seriously going to be 20 individual lawyers that those complainers can go to get the right sort of proper advice that they should be entitled to? So that has to be considered as well. But in principle, yes, absolutely.
Mr. Murray?
Absolutely in favour of that. I don't think any reasonable proponent of law and the legal system would argue against it. I think that, again, the line has to be drawn, and it's a dangerous line to find, because the Crown, of course, prosecute in the public interest, and that is their role in court. And we have to be careful that by allowing a representative for a complainer to come into the process, that we're not allowing them to go too far and effectively be minuted in as another party to the process. That has significant risk, and that has to be avoided, I think, at all cost.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. If I can just remind members just to confine questions to part four. I know I'm being precious, and I said I wasn't going to be. Can I bring in Russell Finlay, then Katie Clark?
Thank you, Convener. The Faculty's written submission says that the system ostensibly works, yet the head of Rape Crisis Scotland told us last week that she thinks, and I quote, "It's obvious to anyone that guilty men are regularly walking free." So do you think that rapists are walking free, or is she wrong? And that's for Ronnie Runuchi.
There's going to be undoubtedly cases where people are convicted when they shouldn't be convicted, and there'll be cases when people are acquitted when undoubtedly they should be convicted. I don't know what the number of cases, the percentage where that occurs, but that's undoubtedly going to happen. But that's going to happen in any criminal justice system.
So there's almost as many being wrongly convicted as there are being potentially wrongly acquitted.
No,
I
simply said that there will be cases where people are wrongly convicted. There will be cases where people are wrongly acquitted.
I mean, one of the problems we've had is a lack of data, not just, and indeed the flaws with the research that have been identified by the panel. You have told us today you've represented up to 300 men accused of rape. Can you even tell us roughly the breakdown of verdicts in your cases between guilty, not guilty, and not proven?
I honestly couldn't. What I can say is there is a significant difference, and I would be surprised if the data now were not changing more towards conviction, and that's partly because of changes in the way that the law has evolved. And of course, one must trust the courts. The courts have evolved the law, certainly in recent years. And the Court of Appeal have made it clear that, you know, the courts have to move, as it were, all with the times. There's a modernisation of the law, a modernisation of approach. The way that, for example, the Murov law has been expanded, the way that the applications in terms of Section 275, there's been a much narrower interpretation of Section 275 than was perhaps taken previously. All these factors have affected, I think, the way that rape trials are certainly conducted. And I'm in no doubt that it's in a way that will be fairer to the complainers.
And then I guess with Smith v Lees coming into play, that will again
precisely
alter things. Okay. In its submission, the Crown Office points to the Scottish Jury Manual, which Mr Murray referred to earlier on. It provides guidance to judges in directing juries. And it says that if a juror is satisfied beyond reasonable doubt, and I quote, it is your duty is to convict, otherwise they would need to deliver either not guilty or not proven verdict. So the Crown say that if not proven was scrapped, it's not clear why a juror who was not convinced of guilt would be considered more likely to return a guilty verdict. And that appears to be at odds with your collective position, that jurors might be forced to return a verdict they're not comfortable with or not convinced by. Can you perhaps explain that anomaly or explain that reasoning? I guess Mr. Runuchi or anyone that might care to take it.
Again, that may be the Crown Office view. I don't know what the answer is in relation to that. I don't know what would make jurors go from one verdict to another, because there's simply not proper research there that would determine that.
But if the instruction from the judge is they must only convict if sufficiently persuaded beyond reasonable doubt.
Absolutely.
Then if they're not, then they will reach for not guilty, if not proven's not there to have.
Well, one would think that would be the natural way of it, but our jury research and the information that we've been given says something different, because that suggests that, as I understand it, Fiona Leverick suggested that in their research, if you take away not proven, then it was going to, without any figures, that it was going to swing towards conviction.
I mean, the Crown seemed to be suggesting that might be indeed what happens. What they seem to be saying in their view is that more acquittals will potentially result. And I want to move on. This is a question perhaps for all three of you, and it's about the potential for a retrial. The Crown appear to be arguing that this should be an option in Scotland if... Anyway, but if indeed these changes are made, do you have any views on that? And that's perhaps open to all three of you.
Well, I think the current law in England, as I understand it, is that it is possible to have a retrial. And of course, the difference between the English system, as I understand it, and I'm clearly not qualified in that system, and the Scottish system, is that it is allowed, essentially, for a jury not to reach a verdict. And of course, that's just simply not possible in Scotland. There requires to be a verdict. In England, there can be a retrial because a jury has been unable to reach an appropriate verdict. I think that's an added layer that, frankly, I'm unsure of. And I suppose, reverting back to my previous comment, there is just an absolute lack of appropriate research on matters such as that. And most of the things that we speak about and most of the commentary that's made is essentially based on anecdotal evidence. And that's something that if any broad sweeping change to the system is to be made, that's something that I revert back to, that proper investigation and research has to be carried out.
But if we're pushing ahead, if it's likely the government is intending to change jury sizes, the majority, the removal of not proven, should the bill also use that opportunity to bring in the opportunity to have a retrial? I mean, it might be one for Ms. Munro.
Yes, thank you. I think there are different ways of looking at this, and I may have misunderstood the Crown submission, and forgive me, please, if I did, that almost if we had a qualified majority system as provided for in the bill, there might be some scope within that for the court to be allowed to order a retrial where a majority wasn't considered to be or a particular verdict or a particular majority had been reached, and I think there would be concern about that. But if you look at the English model, as Stuart was talking about, and it can be hard for lawyers in Scotland to get their heads around it, that there requires to be near unanimity or unanimity for any verdict. So it's not that if you can't find enough for guilty, then there's automatically an acquittal, as you would have here. You require that unanimity for a not guilty verdict as well as for a guilty verdict. And what's remarkable about the English system is how rarely juries fail to actually reach a conclusion one way or another. Now, the figure of about 1% is often banded about, but back in 2014 when the expert group on corroboration reported, they dug into those figures and it turned out that the hung jury rate in England included cases where juries failed to reach verdicts on individual charges. So there might be 10 charges in an indictment, the jury convict in 8 but can't reach a verdict in 2, for instance, and it might be that those are 2 significant charges, it might be they're not. But the rate of retrials that the expert group, I think basing on earlier research by the Scottish Government or the Scottish Office, concluded would be single figures in Scotland if we adopted the English model. And in terms of the question of whether that's a bad thing, I mean, I appreciate there are resources implications, but there's an argument, say, that's exactly what juries should be doing. Again, looking at a case from America where this whole question of majority verdicts came up, the judge said, who can say whether any particular hung jury is a waste? Rather than an example of a jury doing exactly what the majority said it should, deliberately, carefully and safeguarding against overzealous prosecutions. So the point is, there might be cases where a retrial in that context is absolutely right and proper, but it's not something that we should regard as being inherently likely to happen very often.
Okay. I mean, 2 weeks ago, Professor Fiona Leverick and Eamon Keane, to my surprise, told us that they opposed the 812 proposition. Mm-hmm. They believed it should be typical with international other international jurisdictions, either unanimity or 10 or 11 out of 12. I was surprised by their position, and I just wonder if you think that, given that's consistent with the position of the legal profession, that the Scottish Government should perhaps rethink the 8 out of 12?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah. So unanimity or perhaps something like 10 or 11 out of 12?
Strive for unanimity, but if that can't be achieved, then 10 or 11.
Right, okay, thank you.
If we're going down to, if we go down to 12.
Yeah, yes. Thank you. Okay,
thank you. Katie Clark, then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. And my first question is for Ronnie Radice, who focused on the fact that we are lacking in evidence in Scotland, or indeed any research really to draw any conclusions, but referred to some work that's been done in England. And we will look at that. But could you maybe summarise in terms of your understanding of any conclusions or indeed a lack of conclusions that there might have been in that work looking at jurors in England, which might be relevant to the legislation that we're looking at now, what your understanding of that research is? I appreciate you didn't do the work yourself.
It obviously can't be relevant in relation to the question of not proven, for example, changing jury sizes. It's perhaps more relevant if you were coming to look at other aspects of it, and that was in relation to issues of what juries actually think and juries believe, and it was in relation to issues of rape myths. And things like that. It was quite specific, and it dealt with really sexual offence cases to a great degree. Mm-hmm. And so it's perhaps not exactly on point in relation to what we're discussing today, but it would be in relation to other matters. I was simply pointing out that there is real research out there involving real juries which gave an indication of how juries thought and what juries did once they get into that jury room, and that is obviously something we know absolutely nothing about.
Yeah, well, I think what you've said is very helpful, but it also does point out that it's possible to do such research, which I think is one of the points, and that obviously hasn't happened.
At present, Scotland, it's not possible because of the law. You cannot ask a juror anything about the
right. So that's one of the reasons why.
I think there has been some debate about the extent which it is or it isn't, and I think Cheryl Thomas subscribes to the view that we collectively have been a bit restrictive in our interpretation of the Contempt of Court Act. She thinks that you can go further than some other people think you can, but that has to be resolved. Can I just make a point in terms of the research that Cheryl Thomas has undertaken? Ronnie's absolutely right. Her research, by definition, hasn't looked at whether we should have 15-person juries or whether we should have simple majorities. But she has looked at other elements of the system down south. So an example of it is routes to verdict and written directions. And she produced some pretty startling results, which identified that they were regarded by juries as tremendously helpful in allowing them to navigate the process of coming to decisions in criminal trials. So the research might suggest other things that don't currently exist in the bill that may be worth looking at.
The legislative framework's slightly different in Scotland than England in relation to what academics can do. Is that the case? Yes.
Substantially different.
Uh-huh. So therefore, that's been a real barrier in Scotland because we've got a lot of academics.
And just to be very clear, the research that Cheryl Thomas carried out at University College London was long-awaited and groundbreaking research that should not be ignored in this jurisdiction.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of jury majority, so obviously a lot of the other issues would not translate easily into the Scottish system, but in terms of jury majority, is there much work that you're aware of in England in relation to jury majority and how common it is either in England or indeed in other jurisdictions? And I know Stuart Munro's spoken about other jurisdictions and referred to statistics elsewhere. How common it is to get a unanimous decision where a unanimous decision isn't required, or a majority is? I don't know if Stuart would like to come in.
Statistics are, but I would be amazed if they weren't available.
So you think there will be...
I would think the Ministry of Justice would be able to produce that material without too much difficulty.
It may well be that looking further than jurisdictions in the United Kingdom mm-hmm. is required. Certainly, my understanding is that there's been a fairly significant amount of research carried out in America, particularly in the Chicago courts. I think Stanford have carried out a survey mm-hmm. And research in relation to unanimity or there or thereabouts unanimity and anything that falls short of that. And so that's something that could be undertaken here also. Mm-hmm.
And as far as you know, the Scottish Government haven't looked at that kind of evidence. Or are you sure they haven't looked at it? It may well be they have carried out that work, and that's how they've come to this proposal of 8 out of 12, which may be plucked out of the air or may be based mm-hmm. on evidence. Do you have any knowledge in relation to that? Or are you... No. It was Ronnie Reducci who said plucked out of the air. Are you sure it's been plucked out of the air, or do you think it might be evidence-based?
I was unaware of any evidence.
I'm not aware of any either, so thank you.
That's why... Uh-huh. I say it hasn't been presented to us as mm-hmm. any evidence. And
okay, thank you very much.
Can I just say something? It seems to me that we trust juries in this country with decision-making responsibility in relation to really quite complex issues. Issues, for example, of a medical nature, of a forensic nature, of forensic accounting matters. And if there are, as it seems to be the case, that people doubt the reliability of juries and the system, then what I would say is this, it's long been said...
Well, we're not dealing with that at the moment. We may be dealing with that after Christmas.
I want to make this point generally, that there is often said that there is merit in a Scottish education, and so most of the issues that this committee is dealing with today and prior and subsequent to this hearing today, they can be dealt with in the forum of jury trials by educating juries, educating the general public. It doesn't necessarily mean that we have to piecemeal dismantle the criminal justice system in Scotland to get mm-hmm. what we want.
Mm-hmm. I think what we're trying to focus on in this session is whether changing the numbers is going to make a substantial difference. So if we made it unanimous, for example, would that make much difference to the conviction rates or not? And we don't really have any evidence from this jurisdiction anyway, as far as I can understand. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Pauline Neil, then John Swinney.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I start with the first question to you, Stuart Munro? So this question of the three verdict system has been long debated in Scotland. You might remember that Michael McMahon, Labour member, had the bill many years ago. So I just wondered if you thought if we retain it and the Parliament decides to retain it, if you think that we're always going to be discussing the three verdict system, given that it is unusual. And the second part to this question, do you think the government's rationale for changing it is clear or not?
I think the answers to those questions are probably yes, we will continue to debate it. Mm-hmm. And yes, the rationale is clear. That doesn't mean to say it's necessarily correct, but mm-hmm. you know, a clear and cogent argument is presented as to why the not proven verdict does not fit with what others might regard to be a sensible criminal justice system model. That doesn't mean that we necessarily should get rid of it. It is part of our system. It's a unique feature of our system, and our system, broadly speaking, works as a whole with that feature within it. I think you can make perfectly rational and reasonable arguments against it. You can make arguments in favour of its retention. But I certainly think it's a perfectly fair discussion to have.
Thank you. Stuart Murray, can I ask you, given that you had an exchange with Keita Clark about the research that the government are relying on, so in the policy memorandum, it's quite clear this is the evidence they are using for removing the verdict, the 900 jurors. Do you think the government would be taking more seriously on that research if we address the question of the contempt? Is it the Contempt of Court Act and made perhaps, if we legislate for this as part of this bill, to allow some research to be done on what juries or the trends of juries and how they come to the decisions. Do you think that would be taken more seriously, Stuart?
I think undoubtedly it comes back to the point that I rather candidly attempted to make a few moments ago about education, and that's all part, you know, educating people, including lawyers, is all part of research, is all part of that. And if we want to be able to view the jury system, the justice system, on a par with our colleagues south of the border, then we need to consider how we do that.
And do you think it would be a good use of Parliament's time then to take the necessary legislation to allow for the Cheryl Thomas has done? Do you think that would be useful?
Well, I have to say that I'm very familiar with Cheryl Thomas's research. Mm. I am also familiar with the commentary she's made about how perhaps we've been too reserved in Scotland in looking at that and how we address it. And so I'm all in favour of exploring that. How that's done, I'm not sure, but I think it would be churlish to suggest that it would be a waste of time for Parliament to look into that issue.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My last set of questions is to you, Ronnie Ranucci. Ronnie, do you think, you've probably seen some of the exchanges on the official report of this committee in relation to the three verdicts and the evidence last week from Joe Duffy and Rape Crisis Scotland. So in your opening remarks, you said to the committee about, you talked to the committee about what the Crown had to prove. Do you think there's been enough discussion about what juries are actually, how a judge charges the jury, if you like, rather than just debating cold clinical aspects of removing the verdict? Do you think it would be more wholesome to discuss what the jury are actually asked to do when they're deciding on a conviction or not?
There have already been changes made, and again, it's something that Scotland's come to slightly later. Cheryl Thomas, some of her recommendations and some of the things that she had pointed out was the impact that written directions to the jury before the trial starts, the effect that that's had, and we now have written directions which are given to the jury. Although they're written, they have them, they retain them with them when they go into the jury room, but they are read out by the judge at the start of the trial. So we now have a situation where juries are better informed before we even hear a bit of evidence. The difference, in England we have opening speeches, in Scotland it's often said we just go straight into the evidence, and the jury are... up until recently, I've been really ignorant about what was going to happen. It's certainly been more effective in telling the jury, or at least giving them an understanding or an idea of what is going to come. I am certainly in favour of educating the jury and giving them as much information mm-hmm. as is required to enable them to carry out the task that they have been given, which is arriving at a true and just verdict. Anything that assists the mm-hmm. jury in coming to that decision, I am in favour of.
And of course, sorry to interrupt, but that is an issue that was raised by Lady Dorian in her recent review paper in relation to the Victims, Witnesses and Reform Scotland Bill, that there can be more done to educate the jury in relation to specific
what I'm
matters.
Really, yeah, thank you. I suppose what I'm really driving at is fair to say, because none of us have practised, or apart from Katie Clark, practised criminal law in court, so we are learning as we go. Is it fair to say, though, that the instructions that the jury will be given will be primarily around the Crown proving its case beyond reasonable doubt? In other words, the first question is not what verdict are you going to choose? Is it fair to say that the jury will be directed to decide guilt or innocence, and then they have to decide which verdict they think is appropriate?
funnily enough, the three verdicts that are available come, those directions are given to the jury at the very end, just before they're sent out. The directions at the start are to do with there is burden of proof, the standard of proof. They're also given it in relation to Murov, for example, that can be explained to them as well. But there are also directions in relation to witnesses, statements, what witnesses will say, etc. So the actual verdict part of it forms a very, very small part of the overall charge. So you may have a judge's charge to a jury which might take 2 hours, but it may only be 2 minutes of that, if that, right at the end, where the jury are directed as to what their verdicts can be.
Thank you. Just lastly, so this question of the numbers on the jury, if they were to remove the not proven verdict, and the profession prefer a unanimous jury, but would, secondary to that, would accept, as in England, a 10-12 majority, if, and I understand your fundamental position is to retain the not proven verdict. I just wondered, Donna, if you could talk the committee through then, what would you think the Crown would have to show in order to get a conviction? See, to a layperson, what you're saying is, well, the jury would require to have a 12-12 before you could convict. And that sounds like really difficult then to get a conviction, whereas 10-12 does seem to allow for it. But then that's, you know, it's, we don't understand how juries operate, and we don't understand how the proceedings of courts.
Sorry, I wasn't suggesting that should be the case. Would be unrealistic. What I was saying was that we should strive for unanimity.
Right.
But we have inbuilt that there is already that, as opposed to England, where you're looking for unanimity. If they can't get unanimity, then after a certain period of time, the judge can advise the jury that they will accept a majority verdict. I'm not suggesting that we have that system in Scotland. Okay, it's simply that any striving towards unanimity, but obviously that there is a fixed majority that would be accepted, whether that be 10, okay, that allows for 10, 11 or 12. But I'm not suggesting that we start off by saying it has to be 12 and then we work down from that.
Oh, that's helpful. And just lastly, given the hundreds of cases that you've done, you've...
Sorry, can I just interrupt? Did you want to come in on that?
Make a point just in response to that. It is superficially attractive to think, well, if we require unanimity, say, or we require 10-2, then that's going to be harder to result in convictions as opposed to 8-7. What that doesn't then explain is why conviction rates in rape cases are higher in England than they are currently in Scotland. And the illustration of the English figures, and I don't have them in front of me, demonstrates that there is a fallacy in that argument, that ultimately it is possible to secure convictions, and indeed a relatively high rate of convictions, under a model that requires 12-0 or 10-2.
Thank you. Just the last question I want to ask Ronnie Rinucci about the... In your experience, and I realise it's just your evidence, what we've been hearing that the not proven is used a lot in rape cases. And I just wondered if you had any sort of comment on whether or not there's a tendency for not proven verdicts in relation to rape cases.
I'm not quite sure where that information came from, because I'm aware that there was a freedom of information question that was asked of the Scottish Parliament. It takes from 2015 to 2020. And the response to that, in the reality was that the verdict of the three verdicts, not proven, not guilty and guilty, in rape and attempted rape cases, the verdict that was returned the least was not proven. The verdict that was returned the most was guilty. It's when you combine the not guilties with the not proven that you thereafter have a majority that are acquittals. But not proven was the one that was used the least. In 2015-2016, there were 59 not guilties, 45 not provens and 104 guilties. In 2016-17, it was 106 not guilties, 42 not provens and 98 guilties. And then moving on, it was 87 not guilties, 48 not provens, 106 guilties. 2018, it was 97 not guilties, 70 not provens, 142 guilties. And up to 2020, I'm unaware of any data after this date, it was 95 not guilties, 74 not provens, and 130 guilties. So in some ways, the not proven verdict has been slightly maligned, perhaps unfairly, I'm not quite sure, but it's certainly not the verdict that is the, as it were, the go-to verdict in rape cases.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. John Swinney.
Thank you, Convener. I think if we're to try to address Paul McNeill's point about perennial discussion about not proven, I think it might help us to understand exactly what not proven means. And I'm struck by the reference in the faculty submission, which describes not proven as a measured means of acquittal. Measured means of acquittal. And I just would be grateful for an explanation of what is the thinking behind that description of not proven and what it actually, what that means.
I think that really comes back to what used to be the direction that was given, which was it's a matter of emphasis. And it was, Stuart's correct, the jury manual now is directs that really, if a jury come back, and it is a question that is relatively, well, it's not frequently asked, but it's certainly asked by juries, what's the difference between not proven and not guilty? And now they're told that there's no difference, that the outcome is the same, it's one of acquittal, and that is the only information that they're given. But previously, a jury was usually told by the judge that it was really a matter of emphasis.
A matter of emphasis about what?
In relation to their verdict. In relation to whether or not the difference between not guilty, where you're categorically, the jury are categorically saying to someone, you are not guilty, that is their finding, as opposed to not proven, where it's more likely that what they are, for example, they may be saying is that the Crown have failed in their duty or their task in proving the matter beyond a reasonable doubt. I suppose there are two interpretations of that. So you have that not guilty, we're saying this person is not guilty, and then are not proven where they're saying the Crown have failed in their task and have not been able to prove the case against this person.
But there is probably another sentence that goes with that, which is that an interpretation of not proven in those circumstances where the Crown has been deemed to have failed to have proven beyond reasonable doubt and the jury is unconvinced the individual is not guilty, that they are somehow, forgive my colloquialism, sort of guilty?
No, not at all. It's not the case that they're unconvinced that the person's not guilty, because that's not part of their task. They're not there to decide if the person is not guilty. The primary function is to decide whether or not the Crown have proved the case against the accused. It's no part of a defence. The defence, there's no requirement on a defence to prove that the person's not guilty. The burden is entirely on the Crown.
No, but I understand that. But the point I'm getting at is, what is the definition of not proven in circumstances of the type that we're talking about here, where the jury is not convinced that the Crown has proved its case beyond reasonable doubt, but that there is space for there to be a measured means of acquittal, which sounds to me like a conditional acquittal, which, going back then to what you've just put on the record, Mr. Ranucci, about the point that a judge will say, or if a jury asks what's the difference between not proven and not guilty, a judge will say there's no difference. Whereas, in actual fact, the faculty submission suggests there is a bit of a difference.
But it all goes down to, as you said, what's the definition of not proven? In reality, is we don't know what the definition of not proven is. But there must be a difference. It stands to reason there must be a difference. If some juries return verdicts of guilty, some juries return verdicts of not guilty, and some return verdicts of not proven, there must be a difference. But we don't actually know what that difference is.
But a judge, in answering a jury's question, what's the difference between the two, will say, am I correct, there is no difference?
There's no practical difference because both result in a verdict of acquittal. Mm-hmm. That's as much as really can be said.
And Mr Murray, in the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association submission, it states a juror may think that the accused is guilty, but be unsure as to whether or not the Crown have proved that beyond a reasonable doubt. It is this lack of assurance as to guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, alongside a belief that an accused may not be innocent, that requires there to be a third option. Now that, again...
Well, it's a safety...
Forgive me. That is suggests to me there is some residual doubt left on the accused when, in fact, going back to the point that Mr Ranucci made a moment ago, a judge will say in answering the question, there are two types of acquittal.
So just to be clear, the focus in a trial is on the test, and the test is, have the Crown proven beyond a reasonable doubt, proven guilt beyond a reasonable doubt? It's not for the accused to prove anything. And so there are times when, and it again might be churlish to suggest that, well, let me restart this. A judge will direct a jury to ignore any emotion contained within the trial, whether it be on the behalf of the complainer, and often these are highly emotive circumstances, or the accused position, or any witness for that matter. Ignore, not only ignore the emotion, but in fact can be directed to ignore the consequences for an accused person. Certainly that's contained within the jury manual. The test is only about proof beyond a reasonable doubt, but it would be churlish to suggest that there are no circumstances at all whereby jurors hearing these often very emotive pieces of evidence may have some sort of moral dilemma. And that is an example of why it is vital that we retain the not proven verdict, because there are a number of influences put upon individual jurors and they require that safety valve. So, another issue here is, I don't think there's a real understanding of exactly what or how little a judge will say to jurors, both in respect of the not guilty and not proven verdict, but also in relation to the test of beyond a reasonable doubt. There's very little said in regard to that either. Usually what is said is that a reasonable doubt is something that may cause you to stop and consider something in the conduct of your day-to-day life. Now, that is suitably vague also, and so it is not that there is more emphasis put on something for the Crown than for the defence. It essentially, as Ronnie said earlier, there are no opening speeches in this jurisdiction, and the jury is just given the evidence and they will make of that what they will.
But the point I'm driving at is the potential unsatisfactory nature of where people are left after a not proven verdict. Because if I follow the rationale of the arguments that you've just deployed, an individual who is accused has been acquitted if they've got a not proven verdict. But they may have with them some stain on their character because of the, if I use the terminology, a measured means of acquittal, a conditional acquittal. From the perspective of a complainer, a victim, they, with a not proven verdict, are likely to feel dissatisfied that the outcome they believe should have been achieved has not been achieved. But there is a sort of question mark left about it. And I'm just probing as to whether anybody ends up in a good position as a consequence of that?
Well, I don't think that that is an issue which relates purely to the not proven verdict. I think that we operate in an adversarial system, and very often there are no winners in that system, certainly in respect of how people go on to live their lives. That's just
But you take the point I'm making, Mr. Murray, about the difference between, one will have a fundamentally different view of an outcome if it's guilty or not guilty versus not proven.
Potentially, I have to say that...
Is that point accepted? It leaves people feeling differently about it?
I don't know that. What I can say, and it's all anecdotal evidence because we don't have the research in place, but I could provide anecdotal evidence. And to be clear, it's not often we know what a complainer, and let's be clear about this, in the absence of a guilty verdict, that person is a complainer. They may have a different view on it themselves, but in the law, they're not a victim. Appreciate there's different language and terminology used in this committee and the paper surrounding it, but they are a complainer. I could give anecdotal evidence from information I've received indirectly that some complainers, when faced with a not proven verdict, have taken some comfort in the fact that it was not a clear not guilty, because it could be taken that a clear not guilty is a commentary on the evidence that they gave in court. And there's clearly not enough research being done in relation to that.
Okay.
In response, one thing I will say, and so that we're clear about it, the discussion about not proven can only takes place within the system we have at present, which is the 15 of the jury and the majority, a simple majority. If we were going to a different system, then no one's suggesting that we retain a not proven in relation to that. That is why at the start we said that not proven is one of the integral links, as it were, or building blocks in the system we have at present. Faculty has no difficulty with removing not proven if another safeguard is put in its place. But the response is in relation to the system we had at present, or we have at present, and where it fits in with that system. If we are changing and we're going to a smaller jury size with a different size of majority, then clearly there's no place for not proven within that system. It's the fact that not proven is within our system, and it has its place within our system at present. But if we move away from the system we have at present, then we'd obviously move away from not proven as well.
So the faculty's position would be that if you're going to have the potential for 8-7 decisions in a jury, you've got to have the reassurance of an option like not proven. But there is an alternative to that which you can design, which gets rid of not proven, but you have to take account of the variables that come as a consequence.
We can retain 15, but if we retain 15 and we get rid of not proven, then we would have to change the majority in the 15.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that'd be 12-3, which would be, I think, would be the appropriate majority. I've heard people talking about 10-5. But if you take away not proven, there has to be some safeguard put in its place. And from what Paul McNeill was saying, I'm aware of what happened in 2016. Back then, as I understood it, there was agreement amongst the Justice Committee that there was really no appetite for not proven, but the difficulty came in deciding what went in its place, because that is the difficulty. Something has to go in its place. What is that? And the natural thing would be a change in the majority. And the very fact that those who are recommending that not proven is removed, the fact that the Fiona Leverick and Eamon Keane and various are saying, yes, but if you do remove it, you have to put something in its place. And that's really all we're saying. At the moment, within the system we have, it has to stay. If we're changing the system, then we're not saying, well, any system has to have not proven, because there would be no place for not proven within a different system. But there's certainly a place for it within the system we have at present. But I recognise that there's a consensus to get rid of not proven. But we must obviously replace it with something else. That's simply our position.
Lastly, Convener, if I may, if I could ask Stuart Munro, you made a comment, Mr Munro, about there being a higher conviction rate in England for sexual offences than in Scotland. And I just wonder if you can share with the committee why you think that's the case.
Again, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but I do remember seeing publication of data that related to conviction rates of cases started. So it's not from number of reports made to the police, it's from cases that actually are in court turning into a conviction. And the number that I have in mind was about 71%, I think, in rape cases, compared to something north of 50 in Scotland for the comparable period. I can dig that information out and share it after this committee meeting, if that would be of assistance. I think there's always a danger, I should say, in comparing data from other jurisdictions, because there are inevitably features that come into that.
I think it would be helpful, whatever information you can share with us about that, because I think it does, for me, beg the question. There is obviously an absence of a not proven verdict in England, so to what extent is the absence of that factor contributing towards the difference? You know, if those numbers are correct that you've just given us, you know, and I appreciate your supply those later on, there's quite a material difference between 50 and 71, if that's the case. So that strikes me as being something that really needs to be explored as to what is driving that and what is the significance potentially of the option of the not proven verdict in Scotland, because we have to get to the, you know, we have to understand what are the implications of any move to remove such a provision.
Of course, and the point that, pardon me, I was thinking to make at the end of my last answer was that one has to be careful in taking statistics from one jurisdiction and applying them in another because of the different considerations that might apply. The very obvious different consideration is actually about marking policies. What the CPS decides to do when faced with a reported case, as opposed to what COPFS decides to do. Whether, for instance, in Scotland, maybe because of corroboration, there is more of a sense that any case that meets the corroboration threshold should be prosecuted, whereas in England there's maybe more of an assessment of the, if you forgive the expression, the quality of the evidence, essentially, that a weighing up as to the likelihood of conviction. And that inevitably would have an impact on the conviction rates that you saw going through. Put simply, if you prosecute the cases where you're more certain of getting a conviction, you're probably going to have higher conviction rates than if you don't. So all of those extraneous elements have to be factored in. You then have the trial process. To what extent do things like written directions and routes to verdict assist in the process, increase the prospect of conviction? What about any other elements that maybe we haven't thought about? Timescales, quality of investigations, resources and investigations. So I think we have to tread very carefully when looking at that kind of data. But the point of referring to it was simply, we shouldn't assume that requiring unanimity or something close to it means that you're never going to get any convictions, because that simply isn't borne out by the data from elsewhere.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're over time. I'm just going to come in, if I may, with a very final question, and then we'll draw the session to a close. And it's, it's for Stuart Munro. And it's in relation to the survey of members that the Law Society undertook. And my understanding that was that there were over 70% of members who responded believed that the not proven verdict should be retained. So I'm just wondering if you could maybe just expand a little bit on the survey and the results, including the minority view, which obviously consisted of around about 30%.
I think the difficulty is that if you ask 100 lawyers for their view on something, you'll get about 120 responses, the Society went to its membership with a predefined questionnaire which it invited people to respond to. And there are caveats that have to go with that. Clearly, in any survey, it's the questions that are asked that may inform the answer. And the question of, do you think we should retain the not proven verdict, might provide a different response if it's framed in the context of, do you think we should retain the not proven verdict if we are moving to a system of unanimity, oblique 12-member juries, and so on and so forth. And that level of detail wasn't asked. I think it's also only fair to say that this is a society of all members of the society. The society represents all solicitors in Scotland, so that includes fiscals. It includes those who don't go anywhere near the criminal courts, you know, conveyancers or commercial lawyers and things of that nature. So that raw data has to be taken in that very clear context. But there were undoubtedly a multiplicity of views. There are a multiplicity of views within the profession. There are those, for instance, whose primary job is to represent complainers, and they may have a different view in terms of the not proven verdict because of the experiences of the clients that they represent. It may be that fiscals asked individually might have a slightly different view to those who work mainly on the defence side of the profession. But I think what we were able to take away from it was there were a range of different views expressed. There was a real sense that the Scottish system is one that we should be proud of, and we shouldn't always be apologising for doing things slightly differently to how it's done elsewhere. But the Society's position ultimately is broadly in line with what Ronnie just described, and indeed the way that Mr. Swinney put it in the final question, that in essence, I think it was suggested that ultimately what needs to be done is to look at whether we can design an alternative to what we already have that meets the concerns, ensures the balance is right, and fundamentally comes back to that primary aim of convicting the guilty and acquitting the innocent.
Okay, on that note, I'd like to thank you all for attending today. We'll now have a short suspension just to allow us to have a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, members. And we now move on to our second panel this morning. So can I welcome Laura Buchan, Procurator Fiscal Policy and Engagement at the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and Mr Alistair McLeod, Principal Procurator Fiscal Deputy at the Policy Division at Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. So welcome to you both, and I intend to allow around about 60 minutes for this session. So I wonder if I can open up with a general question, and it's around the jury research that has been undertaken in Scotland. So can I ask Laura Buchan, what weight would you give to the findings of the available research, including the Scottish jury research, as part of the evidence relating to the proposals in part four of the bill?
Thank you and good morning. I suppose it would be best if I start by saying, obviously, in COPFS we operate as part of the criminal justice system, and that's created and determined by legislation and the decisions in relation to the change of jury size, the abolition of not proven, the size and majority requirements of the jury are ultimately a matter for Scottish Parliament. But we do make some observations in relation in our submission, particularly in relation to the jury research. In our experience as prosecutors, we do urge caution about extrapolating the results from a mock jury research and extrapolating those and putting them on a real criminal justice system. It is unclear to us as prosecutors as to why the removal of an acquittal verdict would tend to lend to an increase in conviction. We know when trials are conducted, and as we heard from our colleagues this morning, almost the very last thing that a jury are told by either the presiding sheriff or the presiding judge are that if the case is not proved beyond reasonable doubt, then they must acquit, and that there are two options for those jurors then in terms of an acquittal verdict, and they are not proven and not guilty. I can go in more detail in terms of the questions about some of the things that we think that we need to highlight in relation to the mock jury research, whilst totally understanding that it is the largest mock jury research of its type in the UK. We understand the limitations that were placed in terms of Professor Lebrick and Eamon when they gave evidence to the committee last week. I myself have sat on a mock jury as a student, and that was in a court setting in which these mock jury research were not. It was undertaken by advocate deputes. There was a judge. There were actors. We as well took it seriously and earnestly, but ultimately we knew that the ultimate decision that we made would not impact either a real victim or an accused. So it's really difficult to replicate a real jury sitting in mock jury results. And I suppose we urge caution because we worry about an unintended consequence when the aim of this bill is to improve a service to victims and witnesses, and in fact improve the system for all users, including accused, that by changing, for example, the majority of a verdict, that we will see an increase in acquittals, and that would be an unsatisfactory outcome. Mm-hmm. We appreciate, though, that not proven is unsatisfactory for both accused and for many witnesses.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. And I suppose it's probably helpful to point out that the research, the mock jury research that we heard about from Professor Fiona Leverick and Eamon Keane, that's part of the sort of evidence that the committee will take. So I think it's just important that I wouldn't think for one minute that the provisions in the bill are based solely on the findings of mock jury research. But thank you for that helpful response. So I'm just now going to open it up to members, and I'll bring in Katie Clark, then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. And I've got a question that really comes from what was said in the previous session, and I think both of you were in for that sessions. So it was to do with this issue, to do with the Contempt of Court Act and the fact that we're relying on mock jury research because there's a view that it's not possible to carry out research in relation to real jurors. And I just wondered if that was something that you'd looked at, whether you thought that was the reason that there wasn't academic research on real jurors in Scotland, or whether you had any information in relation to that, if I maybe ask Laura Buchan.
Absolutely. We know, again, as prosecutors, that the jury deliberations are confidential. We don't know what deliberations take place, and that's why it's very difficult. And obviously, you're hearing the evidence this morning, talking about why not proven might be returned. We can hypothesise in terms of why jurors determined to return a not proven verdict, but nobody knows because the confidentiality of those deliberations. The most we will know at the end of a trial is whether a verdict is unanimous or by majority, and that's all the information we have. So it's very difficult, again, from that information to know what weight is put on different verdicts and why different verdicts are chosen. And yes, I think at the moment jurors are not spoken to in terms because of the Contempt of Court Act, as I understand. And I think, as my colleague Stuart explained, it is to a certain extent to protect those deliberations in terms of confidentiality and in terms of weight, in terms of number of majority.
I think Stuart also said that he wasn't convinced that necessarily it was correct that it wasn't possible to carry out research, and there'd been discussion about this in England. It's a UK-wide piece of legislation, as I understand it, and because there was a lack of clarity, the UK government in Westminster, they brought forward legislation to enable research to take place. Do you think it is clear that we just can't carry that research? I just wonder if that particular aspect, that narrow issue, is something you'd given any consideration to, and it could just be a yes or no answer.
No, I haven't. I don't know
whether that's fine.
My colleague Alistair has...
The only thing I was going to say is I'm unaware of the changes that Westminster may have implemented, but in terms of the research in England, I think it's important to note that Professor Chalmers' research, although conducted with jurors, was a study that was undertaken with individuals who had sat on a jury. The research wasn't in respect of the jury that they had sat on. They were simply identified as people who had sat on a jury and were then asked questions. So in a way, it's just an expansion of mock jury research. However, the selection of people that you are questioning have recently sat on a jury. They weren't discussing the deliberations or the jury that they had recently sat on, but merely were identified as individuals who had sat on the jury, which is my understanding of the research.
Thank you.
Sorry, thank you. Pauline McNeill, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Good morning, Dallas. I wonder if you have any comment to make on some of the evidence we've heard on the use of not proven in relation to rape cases. I'm trying to understand this myself. So there's the use of the not proven in relation to not guilty in rape cases, and then there's compared to other crimes, which is going to look different, I imagine. Is there anything you can tell the committee in terms of your experience or practice about the use of not proven in rape cases? Do you have any concern that it's used too often, or no concerns at all?
I think what we can see, and I think it's a Scottish Government document that relates to it in terms of the use of not proven, is that not proven is not a verdict that's used, you know, significantly, and I think in terms of the Scottish Government paper, in terms of summary cases, I think not proven returns in about 1% of cases. But what we do know is it is used more regularly in relation to sexual offence cases. So I think, I mean, I can refer you, sorry, I'm just trying to find the figures here, but there's certainly a difference in the way that the verdict is returned in relation to sexual offence cases as opposed to other cases. But again, it's difficult to know why.
I understand. Do you have any view on why that would be the case? No.
I mean, I think as we discussed earlier, I mean, what we can say and what we do know in relation to convictions generally, convictions in relation to rape and sexual offences cases are lower than any other types of case. So in terms of about 4 out of 10 conviction for rape and serious sexual offences, and it's far higher in terms of other offences. And, you know, we could talk, and our colleagues earlier spoke about just the difficulty in prosecuting sexual offence cases. So that will no doubt have some impact in terms of if we as prosecutors and with our colleagues in the defence bar know how difficult and complex sexual offence cases are, how traumatic they are for the victims and witnesses, then it really is, we can see how for juries too that those cases are difficult. But what we really want to do is improve that system for victims of violence, women and children, particularly specifically in relation to sexual offence cases. In terms of the conviction rates, what we should say is, again, we know that we obtain and secure convictions in cases where there are multiple victims. That, I suppose, is not surprising to a certain extent in terms of a jury hearing the evidence. We also know that in cases, in serious sexual offence cases or sexual offence cases, where children are victims, the conviction rate is slightly higher. Anecdotally from our prosecutors, both in the High Court, or anecdotally from our prosecutors in the High Court, that conviction rate is far lower when you have a single complainer and a single accused.
Thank you, that's really helpful. I said this at the previous session, so most of us are lay people, so you know a lot of the practices we'd be unfamiliar with, and particularly in relation to prosecution policy. I mean, broadly speaking, when you're marking cases in relation to, say, a rape case, for example, presumably there's some guidance to prosecutors on what, how you decide whether the evidence is there in order to take a case forward. Is it harder in rape cases than other cases?
I think it's important to set out, again, in front of the committee in relation to the way you know, other evidence has been heard. There's been comparison to other jurisdictions, and again, we would urge caution in relation to that. We are a unique legal system. We have our own criminal justice system. So it's very difficult to compare it to other jurisdictions. In relation, there are robust checks and tests throughout our system in relation to any case. So when any case is reported to us, our primary consideration is whether there's sufficient evidence in the case, and we consider that, and we then consider whether it's in the public interest to prosecute that case. In sexual offences and rape, that's considered by a case preparer and they consider that evidence thoroughly. That is then considered by a senior legal manager to determine whether there is a sufficiency of evidence. That is then ultimately considered by an advocate who will agree or disagree about whether there's a sufficiency of evidence and ultimately whether we should prosecute. So those types of serious cases go through a range of tests to ensure that there is a sufficiency of evidence there. And that is before we make the decision as to whether we are going to take it into court and prosecute. And I suppose it has been mentioned today, but we also have corroboration in Scotland, and that can be distinguished from the system in England and Wales, where there is no requirement for corroboration. And that's another in-built check in the system in terms of prosecuting those cases too.
Thank you very much. Just lastly, in relation to the submission where you talk about if there was an increase in the majority required for a jury to convict, consideration should be given to the prosecution being able to seek a retrial where the higher majority is not reached. I just wondered, is that your policy position? And in other words, are you arguing for that anyway? I mean, why would you not argue for a retrial policy in relation to the current verdict system? And how radical a suggestion is that? Just from a layperson's reading, that does seem quite a radical thing to then introduce the question of, while we've been debating the three verdicts and the majorities, what you've thrown into the mix is that there should be scope for a retrial, and I have absolutely no idea how radical or otherwise that is, but if you could speak to that, that would be great.
I will speak to that, thank you, but I will ask my colleague Alistair to, but before that, I just want to set out, obviously in the system that we currently work in, it's unique in terms of 15, currently in relation to 15 jurors, and that majority of 8 for a guilty conviction. My colleague, again, Stuart Munro, here said this morning, he opened by saying we currently have a broadly safe system. Now that is, as it currently stands, with 8 out of 15 being for a conviction. So you can have one person, obviously, in terms of one more person, and that will result in a conviction. Our caution is that if that is, at the moment, a broadly safe system, and if the aim of this bill is either neither or either to increase convictions or reduce convictions, that by changing that majority, then there is a risk in terms of increasing the amount of acquittals. And I'll hand you over to my colleague Alistair, who can talk about why it's just particularly in relation to what would be, we feel, unsatisfactory to have a higher amount of persons within a jury voting for guilt, but yet an acquittal would be returned. And so it would be in a very small percentage of cases where we would therefore want the opportunity to seek a retrial.
Thank you. I think the provisions in terms of changing the majority are somewhat unique as well. There has been a lot of discussions about comparing Scotland to a number of other systems. The USA was mentioned, England and Wales have been mentioned. We can mention New Zealand as well. All of these systems are common law systems. And going back to my distant memory of law school, we were always taught the uniqueness about Scotland was it wasn't a common law system and it wasn't a civil system, which is the European version. It was a mixed system. And as a consequence of that, we have a rule for corroboration. We also have the simple majority. In the other systems that we've been compared to, and there's been suggestions we should try and mimic a 10-12 or a 12-12, all of those systems have the ability for retrial. And that's because they seek to have the jury reach unanimity or a majority on either a guilty or a not guilty verdict. So if you don't reach the 10-12 for not guilty, it's a hung jury. The proposals that are before the Parliament just now is that it would only be a requirement for an 8 majority for guilty. So there's no requirement to reach that same majority for not guilty. So you can and you will have a situation where if you move to 12 jurors and you're operating an 8-4, where you will have 7 jurors voting for guilty and 5 jurors voting for not guilty. And I am relatively sure from my experience that the jury will come back and ask a question of the judge, because they do, what do we do now? We haven't reached the 7, but we don't have a majority for not guilty. And they will be instructed under the provisions to acquit. I think we have all accepted that there is an unsatisfactory nature of not proven for both victims and for accused. There is often described as a stain being left on the character of the accused when they're provided with not proven. There is a real concern that if someone is acquitted where there is a 7-5 majority for guilty, there is a remaining stain, perhaps even a more so of a stain for that individual. And in those situations, particularly for victims as well, and jurors and complainers, where they have heard that the majority of the jury believed that the accused was guilty and believed that the Crown had proved its case beyond reasonable doubt, but yet there was an acquittal, that would be an unsatisfactory position to be in, particularly in circumstances where perhaps the jury is reduced through illness or, you know, other reasons why the jury might be reduced. The provisions allow if the jury to go down as low as 9. In those situations, you require a 7-2 majority. So you could have a 6-3 vote for guilty, but there would be a not guilty. And obviously, your 6-3 is your 2/3, your equivalent to your 8-4. But the return would be a not guilty. So in those situations, if the Parliament were not to consider, and if the Parliament is considering changing the majority, it might be worth considering whether that majority should remain for both guilty and not guilty. So if we're requiring unanimity or a 10-12, that should be for guilty and not guilty, like they have in the other systems that we've been compared to. But if that's not the case, provisions for retrial are not unknown in Scots law. The appeal court has the power to order retrial where a conviction is overturned. They have the power to provide the Crown with the authority to re-raise proceedings if the Crown so choose to do so. And also, there's the double jeopardy legislation that was passed by Parliament in 2011 that allow the Crown to apply for permission to hold a second trial, to retry an accused. Now, in those situations, and there were some discussions about the level that this would occur and the number of hung juries that occur, and I think research from England suggests it's about 1%, and there was evidence given that that might just be a single charge amongst other charges. But that could be the murder charge in amongst an indictment of smaller assaults. So it may be a significant charge. And what we are suggesting is not that there is an automatic retrial provision that takes place, an automatic trial takes place, is that the Crown have the ability to ask the court for permission to consider re-raising proceedings on the charges that have not met the majority.
So, you said quite a lot. I just want to clarify that I understand most of it, but as the proposals currently stand, not as the other suggestions as a tenor, is it still the Crown's position that you should still have that option for a retrial on the government's proposal, which is 8-4?
Yes.
You would still argue for that?
In situations in the current proposals where the identified majority for guilty, because it is only a majority for guilty, is not met, but the majority of the jury have returned a guilty verdict. There should be an option.
In your 7-5 scenario?
A 7-5 or a...
But that's clearly...
6-3.
Uh-huh. But that's what the provisions are.
No, the provisions are if the jury returns a verdict for seven of the 12 vote guilty and 5 of the 12 vote not guilty, that would be a not guilty.
Uh-huh.
And
but
our
the Crown's not satisfied with
our position is that I don't think anyone would be satisfied with that. And so there should be the ability for the Crown to consider. And those considerations would be in terms of how we currently consider retrying an individual or re-raising proceedings would be in consideration of the public interest, which would include, I would anticipate, the views of the complainer, although with the advent of pre-recording of evidence, there may not be a requirement for a complainer to give evidence again. But certainly it wouldn't be an automatic decision that we would take, and it may only arise in 1% of the trials that occur, but it would provide, I think, reassurance to the public at large that there is the possibility for an individual who has been found, where the Crown have proved the case beyond reasonable doubt to the majority of a jury, but it hasn't reached the arbitrary number that has been selected for guilty verdicts only.
Would the government not be as well to just legislate, if you're right and there'd be public concern, then why don't we just legislate for 7-5 then?
We could retain it as a simple majority, which I think is probably the most sensible option, because then either verdict has to reach a majority. And so at the end of the day, the decision has been made by the majority of the jury. As soon as you start qualifying majorities, you get non-qualified majority.
But I know what you're saying, but the legislation wouldn't say that if passed.
Passed at the moment, there is a discussion about it, and I think they've noted against the creation of a provision for retrial because of additional trauma for a victim having to give evidence again. And I suppose our position is that is a very finely balanced, and we would want the opportunity in those situations where the seven is returned a guilty to seek, to do the consideration and seek a retrial.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think Rona Mackay, did you want to come in? Just
a small supplementary to the conviction rates in sexual offence cases. Laura, can you say whether you think the Lord Advocate's recent ruling that distress can be used as evidence will have an impact on conviction rates?
I don't think we can tell yet whether it will have an impact on conviction rates. And again, I think it's really difficult in this setting to not conflate it with the discussions we're having today in relation to the abolition of not proven and jury size. It's a significant decision, and by the court, we are working through that decision in some detail to see how it will impact not just the rules of corroboration in relation to sexual offence cases, but actually more widely in terms of other types of offence. But the position remains that in Scotland no one can be convicted on the evidence of one source of evidence, but it has allowed us, it's confirmed of course, that the accused requires to be proved by corroborated evidence but not the separate elements individually. And I think, just as an example, which I think is a good example, is currently we need to corroborate pre the decision we believed we would require to corroborate every step. So in terms of fingerprints, we corroborated two people had to speak to the lifting of the prints, two people had to speak to the comparison. So we're taking some time to go through the terms of the comprehensive ruling really carefully and to work out the impact on our wider caseload. It will inevitably allow us to prosecute more cases and to bring more cases before a court because of that change in terms of corroboration. But ultimately what that might look like in terms of conviction rates, I think it's still too early to tell.
Thank you, that's helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Russell Finlay, then John Swinney.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just picking up on Pauline's line of question about the attempt to seek a retrial in particular circumstances. It's a bit of a rapid-fire question, just from one understanding. Right now, if you were to seek this, you would need to seek the court's discretion. That's what you're proposing. It wouldn't be arbitrary power that the Crown would have.
I think it would depend in terms of how the it was to be legislated. But I think we're talking about what we would understand to be a small proportion of cases where we consider it to be unsatisfactory, where seven of the jury returned a guilty verdict, but it resulted in an acquittal.
Is it not the case, though, that we can't, as things stand, find out the jury numbers, the breakdown?
That's correct, but there may be situations, and obviously this is only likely to arise in situations where it becomes apparent that there was a 7-5 split. So I have conducted jury trials where the jury have come back and said, five of us want to vote guilty, five of us want to vote not guilty, and five of us want to vote not proven. What do we do? And so automatically there is disclosure in the court as to what the jury position is. Now, this is most likely to arise in situations where the jury come back, and in terms of the provisions, where the jury come back and say, we can't reach the eight, but we haven't got a verdict for, we don't have a majority for not guilty. What do we do? And in those situations, they will be instructed to return a verdict of not guilty by the court. But the Crown should have the opportunity, if that is what is disclosed, to apply to the court. And again, I think what we're suggesting is not an automatic right of retrial. It would be similar to the provisions that are undertaken in the double jeopardy, where the accused would have a right to make submissions on that, and the court would judge in terms of whether it's in the interests of justice to grant that authority.
So what discussions have the Crown had with the Scottish Government about this?
Well, in terms of any discussions in relation to the bill and the preparation of the bill, and of course the Scottish Government have seen our submissions in relation to this area, but in terms of, Alistair's the head of our victims and witnesses team, we have regular discussions with our colleagues in the Scottish Government.
Yeah, okay. Because obviously they're not, as things stand, willing to include this. You've lobbying quite hard to have it considered, so therefore is it something that you would seek an amendment to be brought forward if the government isn't forthcoming?
It's something that we would continue to have discussions with our colleagues in Scottish Government about. Of course, it's very dependent in terms of what ultimately the bill will look like.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I think primarily it's an area that we're flagging up. There is the possibility of an unintended consequence of removing the not proven to abolish the uncertainty in decisions, but the provisions might create even more significant uncertainties and looking to try and find a solution that would square that circle.
Yeah, now, as MSPs, we're being asked to radically alter the entire criminal justice process. It's quite daunting. But we have found there's been a bit of a dearth of data, not least in respect of cases of a sexual nature, including rape. We can't establish how many appear to have been reported or are reported to the Crown Office, how many are then prosecuted, how many of those are single or multiple complainers, and the outcomes of each, as in guilty, not guilty or not proven. Now, last week, Rape Crisis Scotland put the blame for this lack of transparency on the Scottish Government. I just wonder if that's something, that specific data is something the Crown Office would be willing or able to share with the committee.
We can share the data, and we can go through, and we might need to discuss this, post this about in terms of what data exactly the committee would want to. We do hold data, and I think as we heard the evidence last week, and it's quite eloquently put forward by Sandy Brindley in terms of the systems that we all use are case management systems, and the systems that Police Scotland use, Scottish Courts Service use and COPFS use are different systems, and they are primarily used for our operations in terms of marking and prosecuting. Therefore, again, pooling data like that from the systems is not straightforward. I can give you, though, I can tell you how many cases there are currently in the High Court, what proportion of those are sexual offence cases. I can tell you how many cases are reported to COPFS every year and how many sexual offences charges are. Yep. But the data that I suspect that the committee would like in terms of a breakdown of conviction rates, and we know, as I said earlier, about anecdotally, our view as prosecutors that there's a low rate of conviction in terms of that intimate rape. It's very difficult to identify what that figure is. We are doing some work both within COPFS and with our colleagues in SCTS and Scottish Government to see what we can do. But it means it's a manual process where we have to pull out cases case by case, and we have to weigh up whether operationally and resource-wise we can dedicate that resource to pool that from our system.
I mean, I just find it extraordinary. We appear to be flying blind. This is critical to everything, and we don't have this basic data. Now, the Bill's policy memorandum says that jurors may be more likely to convict with a two-verdict system. The Scottish Solicitors Bar Association, they say that the removing not proven would, and the word they use is undoubtedly, result in more convictions. However, in your submission, the Crown Office submission, says that the 2019 jury research suggests that opposite would happen and that jurors would be potentially less likely to convict. So I just wonder, is this bill progressing on the false assumption that removing not proven will lead to increased rate of conviction, when in fact it's the opposite? Have you got any views on that?
I think, just as I outlined at the opening of the committee, that we are just urging caution in terms of extrapolating the mock jury research and extending it across to the actual real criminal justice system. So, you know, the mock jury research looked at 64 juries. Today in Scotland, there are 22 High Court juries running and around 25 sheriff and jury trial courts running. So, you know, already that's kind of giving some idea about the amount of jury trials that we run each year and the experience that we can garner. I suppose, in terms of listening to my colleagues earlier this morning, we understand their views in terms of we agree with them in terms of the risks in basing changes on that jury research. I suppose it's then difficult to amalgamate the two views in terms of not wishing to rely on the mock jury research by my colleagues in the defence, but extrapolating that one part in terms of an increase in conviction and seeking to rely on it as to why that there requires to be a safeguard.
One thing Mr. Rinucci said that I've not seen anywhere else is that these mock juries trials lasted 1 hour, which seems incredible and completely artificial. Is that the case?
So from my understanding of reading the mock jury research, and again, you know, no criticism in terms of the, you know, it was really interesting hearing Professor Leverick and Eamon a couple of weeks ago when they gave evidence. Interesting to have an insight in terms of the discussions that were heard by those mock jurors. But the reality, and I think Professor Leverick identified that herself and in the research, you know, spoke about the weakness and the limitations. She said it's not a real jury and the jury know that the trials are not real. The two different, so there was a sexual offence trial and also a non-sexual offence trial. I think they were a little over an hour. They were videos of a trial taking place that were shown to the jurors. So whilst they were in a court building, obviously, there was not that experience of being in a court with a prosecutor, with defence counsel, you know, with the victims, potentially the victims and witnesses giving evidence. I suppose that's just, again, just it's just reflecting on the difficulty and limitations carrying out that research.
Can come back to the research, you know, given how important this is, it just strikes me as incredible that given what we're seeking to do, it seems to be beyond the finest legal and academic brains in Scotland to conduct much more meaningful, robust research while still respecting jury confidentiality and these various other issues. Does that not really need to happen first before we make these radical proposed changes?
I don't think I can answer that other than, again, emphasising we understand what the difficulties and limitations are. It is I've never seen in Scotland a jury have been spoken to about their deliberations and their outcome. And there may be some merit in exploring that. But I suppose in terms of respect to the comment you made, in terms of undertaking the research, they have undertaken the largest mock jury research.
We're being asked to be mind readers of juries when, in fact, there's no reason, realistically, that academia and the legal profession couldn't have conducted some meaningful research, I believe.
Well, there is reason, because currently we're not allowed to speak to jurors. And we're not allowed to, by confidentiality, we cannot ask what their deliberations are.
The Crown Office can't, but I'm just saying, collectively, given what we are looking to do here on the basis of what we think jurors might think currently and might do in future based on the changes, it should really have been done, I think.
It's an area that I've not explored in detail as to how that might be done, but presently it can't be done.
No. OK, thank you. Thank you.
Sorry, could I just come
yes.
back? Can quickly just to clarify one point. You mentioned the Crown Office submissions in relation to the analysis of the mock jury research. Just to confirm that the submissions of the Crown Office is not that the research, the indication is what should be drawn from the research is there will be less convictions in a two-verdict system. And what we're highlighting is that the bill is based on the proposition that there will be more convictions, and we're highlighting that that is not what the research demonstrates. It should also, the research itself accepts that the exact pattern of verdicts returned is unlikely to be reflected. It is unlikely to reflect the pattern of verdicts that would be returned by juries in a wider range of differently balanced cases. So the research itself accepts that you can't draw anything from the verdicts that have been returned. They had a 95% not proven verdicts in the research, which is 4.5 times the normal. So all that we're doing is highlighting that it would be perhaps there should be some caution before extracting from the research that convictions would increase, as that's not what we believe it shows.
That makes sense, but that thing you said at the end about the 95% not proven rate being something like four times the regular, we don't even know what the regular is because we don't have the data.
Well,
where are you getting that from?
Well, the jury itself in its report indicates that the not proven return rate for 2017-18 when the jury research was run was 17%.
If I can just move things on, I know this is important, but if I can move things on and bring in John Swinney.
Can I just carry on that line of discussion with Mr. McLeod, because I think one of the fundamental conclusions that is emerging from the evidence is that whichever bit of this Rubik's Cube you move around, there will be implications for other bits of the Rubik's Cube. And I think what we are trying to feel our way towards is where does the right balance lie in protecting the process of justice. So I'm interested in the extent to which you can illuminate our discussions by where you think the greatest risks lie in changing the existing arrangements. We don't want to end up in a worse position. We clearly want to end up in a better position. But I'm keen to explore where does that all rest in terms of the key factors we have to bear in mind in what might change and what might produce a different set of outcomes to those that we currently have in the criminal justice system.
I'm not sure I have the definitive answer, but what I can say is that when you are considering the balance that is undertaken in the criminal justice system, and in particular in terms of the Scottish system, because we are very keen often to point out the uniqueness of the Scottish legal system, and that's something that has to be considered when we are comparing how other jurisdictions do it and whether we should do something similar to what they have. In Scotland, as Laura has indicated, no one can be convicted on the evidence of a single person, no matter how believable or compelling that evidence is. Now, that is different to other systems that operate in jury trials and jury systems. And in order, so we have the requirement for corroboration, the Crown required to corroborate not just that a crime took place, but also that the accused was the individual that committed the crime. And then a jury is instructed at the end of the deliberations, and the whole question for a jury is, has the Crown proved, beyond reasonable doubt, that the accused has committed the crime? And that is the answer that requires to be given by the jury. It's not a question of, is he not proven, is he not guilty, is he guilty? It's the question is, has the Crown proved beyond reasonable doubt what they have set out to prove and what they've libelled against the accused? And so, on a binary level, the outcome of a jury trial is a conviction or an acquittal. But what we have in the acquittal is sort of two subcategories. But the binary question is guilty or not guilty, or convicted or not, or acquitted. But we have two routes to it. And then we have the simple majority of the verdict. Now, I'm not claiming to be a legal historian, and I know Eamon discussed in some way the history of how we approach duties in Scotland, and I think also the senators in a previous response have discussed the differing views compared to, are we seeking the decision of the jury in its entirety, or are we seeking the decision of 15 members, you know, who are then added together to find the majority, the sort of the very nature of the intrude by, you know, your fellow citizens. It's an individual decision by a citizen. So you have the balance of corroboration, simple majority, and the three verdict system. When you're shortening one or removing one, there may be a tilt the other way. How much that tilt is, I think, is very difficult to establish. What may be of note in the Scottish jury research is there was a question asked of the jurors, individual jurors, which, if I remember correctly, was, what is the correct verdict if you believe the accused is guilty but the Crown haven't proved the case? And I think in two verdict juries, 4% suggested that the correct verdict was guilty, and in three verdict juries, 7% suggested that the correct verdict is guilty. Mm. So we have to be reliant on the jury system, and if we have to trust the jury system that a properly directed juror, properly discharging their oath, will ultimately answer the question as to whether or not the case is proved beyond reasonable doubt. And if they don't find it, we have to rely on jurors to acquit. Removing the not proven verdict doesn't remove the ability for a juror to acquit. It removes potentially the confusion or the unsatisfactory nature of that acquittal, but a juror is still able to acquit. So it's difficult to see what balance is required when you're not removing the ability altogether for a juror to acquit, but merely suggesting that the correct acquittal, if the correct answer to the question, have the Crown proved the case beyond reasonable doubt, the correct answer to that is no, therefore not guilty, rather than no, therefore either not guilty or not proven. The fundamental question hasn't changed. So I think there has to be caution when considering whether there needs to be a balance to make it more people have to be persuaded.
And then an explore. Thank you for that. That's very helpful. But to then go into some of the questions I was putting to a panel from the legal profession this morning about what is the perception of not proven. You know, the words of the faculty, if I remember correctly, it's a measured means of acquittal. But from the Crown's point of view, the judgment that matters to you is, have you proved it beyond reasonable doubt?
And I think we noted that this morning too, in terms of a measured means of acquittal. But we can't know that because we don't know why a jury has opted for not proven.
Yes.
So, again, ultimately, we will know whether the verdict is not proven or not guilty. And to us, it's an acquittal. And the jury are told very clearly about what the result of not proven or not guilty. And again, it was quite helpful in the Eamon given the history about why judges don't make any effort to define not proven and not guilty and just make it very clear that by returning either of those verdicts, it will be an acquittal. So I suppose that was my point earlier about talking about what a not proven might mean. We, I suppose, can think about, and we know that victims say it's unsatisfactory for them in terms of a not proven verdict, and we know that accused who have been acquitted of not proven say it's unsatisfactory for them. But why jurors opt for that, we can't comment on because we just don't know.
Okay. My last question is in relation to the vexed question which you've put in front of us about a 7-5 majority for guilty, but that leads to an acquittal. And I wonder if in the other jurisdictions that we are often compared to, where you might have an 8-4 or 9-3 verdict for guilty, but it leads to acquittal, what the degree of public concern is about that fact?
I can't speak to what the public perception of the criminal justice systems in Canada, England and Wales and the likes of New Zealand are. But certainly in those jurisdictions, there is a requirement for the jury to reach a verdict. So they have to meet, reach that majority for not guilty as well. So they don't have a situation where they come back and say, oh, well, if they do come back and say we can't reach a majority on either verdict, then that's what's classified as the hung jury, and that's the result of it. Now, I'm not sure what the social or positions of victims and accused are when a hung jury is the outcome. It may be something similar to what is experienced when not proven is returned, and that there's that uncertainty. But certainly, there's not, as far as I'm aware, a similar situation in these other jurisdictions where you would where you don't reach the majority because the majority is there only for guilty. The majority is there for all verdicts. So you don't have a 9 out of the 12 voted guilty, but it's a not guilty. It's not. That's a hung jury. 9 out of the 12 voted not guilty. That's a hung jury. Is my understanding on how the systems work. So there is this push for unanimity or near unanimity before a verdict can be delivered.
So the very nature of the decision about the composition of a jury decision is something that is of itself, or can be conditioned or nuanced because of the fact that, to try to avoid that understandable situation that you're putting to us, that you've got 7-5 majority in favour of conviction and somebody gets acquitted. That I understand how that's quite a hard sell.
I think it would just be unsatisfactory to all parties, yeah. In a situation where that was the outcome of a trial and it became known that that was the outcome of the trial.
Thank you,
Convener. Thank you. Dr. McGregor.
Thanks, Convener. Good afternoon to both of you. Really interesting session so far. The questions I was going to ask about, the conversation has moved on, but I do want to go back to them just to provide you the opportunity to clarify for the record, and also I think just to just for myself to try and understand exactly the position. So you've stated quite clearly that under the current proposals, you would be worried about an increase in number of acquittals. And what clarification are you talking about? Those that are currently in the last session, we heard some numbers there about number of convictions, acquittals, and not proven. Not proven and not guilty. Are you worried just about those that are currently not proven, or are you also worried about the numbers that are currently convicted? Just wonder if you can clarify that. In terms of the increase in acquittals going up,
I think the issue is currently we have to, the Crown have to prove to or have proved to 8 out of 15 members of a jury that the case has been proved by the Crown, which is a 53% majority. If you then move that majority to an 8-4 out of a 12, then the Crown required to persuade 67% of a jury that the case has been proved. So there's an increase in the percentage of a jury that you have to persuade for a conviction. So by changing it from a simple majority to requiring more people. Now, this is the other difficulty in terms of the lack of research in the way the current system is operated. We can't tell you how many juries return a verdict that is 8-7.
Yeah.
We could be sitting here and every jury in the land comes back with a 15-0 for unanimous or a 14-1 for majority. There's no way of knowing how many cases are decided on a 7 or on an 8-7. So there may be very few cases. It may be that in a lot of these cases the percentage won't matter and there is no impact. And what I think we're just trying to raise is that there should be some caution in the possibility of, by increasing the majority required in a jury to return for a verdict of guilty only, that this may result in there being fewer convictions. It may not, we can't tell, but we're simply sort of highlighting that this may be an unintended consequence of trying to balance the removal of not proven.
Yeah, and I think that comes back to Russell Finlay's point again there, where, you know, a lot of this does lack, for the reasons that you've outlined, it lacks research and data because we're not able to understand what juries are thinking. So, and like Russell and others have said, I think over the last few weeks, you know, on committee, that, you know, we're beginning to feel the real weight of the decisions that are put on us as a committee now as well. And, you know, because I said these are significant changes. And one thing we don't want to do is to make things, you know, worse for people who use the justice system, particularly victims and witnesses.
What I can say, though, if it hasn't already done, I'm sure the committee, having gathered data and shared it, but if there are particular questions that you think the Crown may be assist with in terms of any data that we hold, then you can ask us and we can provide to the committee what we can.
Thanks very much for that. My second question on this issue is, I think I hear what you're saying there about then the acquittals. It's not just, you're not worried just about the acquittals coming from that current pool of not proven, but also actually of the current pool of convicted because of the higher thresholds. I want to ask again, I do think you've answered this, so you can be brief. The convener will be glad to know, but do you think then it's possible, if we as a parliament decide to get rid of, for want of a better word, the not proven, but leave the jury numbers as they are just now, are you not get any concerns or worries, the reverse of your concerns as put forward by many of the legal profession would be the same, that would possibly, you know, lead to wrongful convictions? I'm just putting that out there.
I think what has to be established is the question that the jurors are asked will remain the same. The decision that the jury will have to make will not alter. They are asked to make a decision on whether or not the Crown has proved beyond reasonable doubt the case to those jurors. There is no change to that test. So it's very difficult to see how a juror who would previously have voted for an acquittal but selected not proven would suddenly, in discharging their duty correctly, decide that they're going to vote for guilty instead. And I should just clarify as well that you mentioned our concerns about convictions coming from the not proven side of it. Not proven is an acquittal. So, you know, acquittal verdict should remain an acquittal verdict. It's difficult to see if not proven was removed and everything else remained the same in the system, consideration would have to be given as to why juries would suddenly start deciding that a case has been proved when the day before they would have decided that it wasn't proved. So our view is that the test when the question asked of the jury doesn't change by the removal of not proven. All that changes is one of the routes to acquittal, one of the options for acquittal changes, but the option of acquittal remains.
Okay. Thanks. That's good.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other members that would like to come in at all? No? No? Okay, thank you very much indeed. We'll pull the session to a close. Thank you both for attending this morning, and that completes our agenda item and
we will now close this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.